Yeah,
please. We're starting a new series of shiurim for us, particularly for women. And Baruch Hashem, I see many of Benot Yisrael, they would like not only listen to lectures, inspiring lectures, it's very good. They want to know a law, a Jewish law. Before we start those lectures, I'll give you some introduction in order to understand law better. And in the future, when you do have a question, you could call Rabbi and ask proper way the question, how you should be asked. Because many people sometimes, they know the question, they cannot express themselves proper way. So when they call the Rabbi, Rabbi just gives them an answer, and they have the, after the, that answer, they have another billion questions, what Rabbi said to us. Why he said like this. Okay, so this book is written by Talmid of Rabbi Eliashiv, a very important book. And he brings all the mitzvot nashim, what mitzvot women are obligated. First of all, introduction, what is mitzvah? A mitzvah, besides being good deed, as people interpret it always, a mitzvah is a good deed. Actually, it comes from the root, the word tziva, tzav. Tzav, it means commandment. Hashem commanded to do so. How many mitzvot do we have in Torah? Tariyag mitzvot, 613 mitzvot. 248 of them are performative mitzvot that Hashem wants us to do, and that's why they're written in Torah in form of command, you shall do so. Like, an example, Uchtavtam al mizuzot betecho v'sharecha, you shall be writing those words on your doorposts. So what this mitzvah is, uchtavtam al mizuzot, so you understand, it's a mizuzah, you shall be writing, you should do this, you have to do this. That's a performative mitzvah, Hashem wants us to do it. Now, there's 365 mitzvot, they call prohibitive mitzvot. They call them negative, there's no negative mitzvot, but they call it prohibitive mitzvot. Hashem prohibited us to, from, Hashem restrained us from doing it. Hashem doesn't want us to do this. Like it says, lo tochlu et adam, don't eat blood. Torah says, don't do this. Or lo telech rachil be'amecha, don't be a gossip in your nation. Don't go and be in the gossip in your nation. You're not allowed to be rachil, bring information from one side to another side. How many mitzvot of those we have? Very easy to remember. How many days a year? 365. So then, prohibitive mitzvot, we have 365. Now, as you know, all Bnei Israel, we stood under Har Sinai, and we accepted upon ourselves that we're going to do the Torah, and we swore to Hashem. We said, Na'aseh v'nishma. We're going to do, perform your Torah, and we're going to listen and understand what you mean. Many people, majority of mitzvot, majority of people, they do it according to how they heard it or saw it from the friend. An example, ask many people how they put tefillin in a shul. They saw how rabbi does it, or they saw somebody else does it. They do it this way. But did they learn mitzvah inside in the book with the details to understand why you do it so, how you do it so? They say, we're not rabbis, leave us alone. That's the wrong approach. And halacha is, everyone from Am Yisrael, they have to know how to do mitzvot in details. And that's, I guess, you. I hope you came here for, to know exactly. Now, I'm not coming to teach you chassidut here. Chassidut, it's on your own chumrot stringencies that you would like to accept upon yourself. I'm coming to teach you halacha, how a bat Yisrael, daughter of Israel, should behave, in which case, in the hand. Now, it's very interesting, when Hashem commanded Torah to Am Yisrael, He said this pasuk, you will find this in Shemot, Kot amar lebet Yaakov, v'tagid lebnei Yisrael. That's what you should say to Bet Yaakov, and that's what you should say to Bnei Yisrael. So, if in the end of the pasuk it says Bnei Yisrael, you understand that Bet Yaakov is somebody else. Who would be Bet Yaakov? Talmud says, Elo Anashim. Bet Yaakov, it's a woman. Whom Hashem wanted Moshe Rabbeinu to approach? First, women.
why such an importance to women? It is true, woman is very important in Am Yisrael, but why such importance? Hashem said, go first tell her. The matter says, first you speak to women. Why? Because they're more careful in mitzvot. And as you know, it's in your praise, in your side, on your side of a praise, that it says the women, once they get the mitzvah, they try to do it complete mitzvah. You know, sometimes men, they look for kulot, they look for leniencies, and they want to do easy way. But the women, if they want to do it, they grab it, they do it till the end. So that's why Hashem wanted us to speak. But another reason, Talmud says, Hashem said already once, I spoke to Adam first, and I didn't speak to Chava. So what happened then? Mm-hmm. It failed. So now first you speak to women, because they strict in the mitzvot, and then they're going to push their husbands to the proper way. So this is going to be tikkun, certain way tikkun, a remedy, and to fix the sin of Chava. Okay. Now, it says in Yerushalmi Berachot, Perektet Alacha Aleph, it's impossible for a woman without a man, and it's impossible for the man without a woman. And for both of them, it's impossible without the Shekhinah. So all the purpose is for us to grow up, to get married, and to bring the Shekhinah down. What's a Shekhinah? It's, you know what's a Shekhinah? It's a person, it's a man, woman, or lady. Who is she? What it is? Shekhinah, it's a godly presence. Now, how to explain it? It's very hard, because many people, they don't feel that feeling. But the Shekhinah, it's kind of feeling of peace, and that you know for sure that somebody is taking care of you. Like a child, when he goes to sleep, with no worries that tomorrow morning he will get his warm breakfast. With no worry that he will get his clean shirt. Why? Because there's mommy home, she's taking care of him. That's a feeling of Shekhinah at home. It's a peace of mind. No problems with parnasah, no problems with health. Mommy is taking care of you. Our mommy is a Shekhinah, you understand? And the father is a Kadosh Baruch Hu, Hashem. So every morning, man says the Baracha, Baruch Ata Hashem, Elokeinu Melech HaOlam, Shelo Asani Isha. What it means? Blessed you Hashem, a King of Universe, that you created me, that you did not made me as a woman. Now, it's not kind of thing that puts you down, no, Chas V'Shalom. It's only in the mitzvot wise, because women are not obligated as much as men to keep all the mitzvot. And that's new, probably for you, but I'll explain it now in a minute. What it means, Hashem, you gave me more mitzvot than a woman, because certain mitzvot, women are really exempt. And they won't be asked. And I'll ask you an example. You know the most important mitzvah of Rosh Hashanah. What it is? No.
Shofar.
Kiyat shofar. How many women they run to the shuls to listen to shofar, right? All of them. And sometimes if they didn't make it, they will ask Tokea, please make it for us separately. And do you know that you're exempt from that mitzvah? You're shocked, right? Oh, how is it possible, Rabbi? What do you say? What do you tell us? Don't tell us to us. Don't teach us such a thing, right? The halacha is, yeah, you are exempt. But it doesn't mean you're prohibited of doing it. Again, it's two different things. Now, you're not prohibited of listening to shofar, but you are exempt. It means if after 120 you come upstairs, and they will not ask you why you didn't listen to shofar on Rosh Hashanah, because you are exempt. Okay? But for sure, it's a good thing to do. It's a minhag. It's a good custom. But it's not mitzvah for you. It's a good custom to go to listen to shofar, because it touches your neshama. It makes you to make tshuva. Right? But still, you're not obligated in this mitzvah. So therefore, Bezat Hashem, if you have 10 kids around, at home, right? It's not strange, that's a regular family of Bnei Yisrael, 10 kids at least, right? So, Hashem helps, to raise them. Shechina helps to raise them, right? Mommy is at home. So what happens that you can't go to listen to Shofar? So would you kill yourself for that? I didn't listen to Shofar this Rosh Hashanah? No. And how many Shalom Bayit stories will come with somebody's phone here? Left? Okay, fine. But okay, so what happens now, or another mitzvah, let me ask you another mitzvah. Or mitzvah of sukkah, to sit in sukkah. Everybody wants to sit in sukkah, right? She wants to join her husband or whatever, but sometimes it's impossible. So what do we do in this case if it's impossible to do mitzvah of sukkah? So what do? You have to stay with the kid at home, he's sick. You are exempt. From the beginning, you don't have to sit in sukkah. Now, it doesn't mean you should separate your husband for that. No. You should be with your husband in sukkah. But if there is such a situation, you have to know the halacha. Who are obligated to sit in sukkah, who are not. Or, otherwise you would not say to your husband, you have to be with your wife, you have to be with me. No, he has to do his obligation. He has to do the mitzvah of sukkah. You are exempt, so you don't have to sit. No. So, how do you bless this blessing? Baruch Ata Hashem, Elokeinu Melech Haolam, She'asani Kirtzono. In the morning you wake up, you say, Baruch She'asani Kirtzono, Hashem, you don't say, some don't say the name of Hashem, that's a minhag. You say, Baruch She'asani Kirtzono, blessed you Hashem that you made me as your will. Meaning that you wanted me, this neshama, to be a female neshama, you brought me as a female to this world. It means you don't want so much of neshamot from me. Do you understand? So much mitzvot from me. Meaning, I did my obligation already and I just have to do what female has to do.
Okay. And why did she in previous life?
Maybe. I don't know. Now, why do ladies at all come to this world? Do you know your reason why you're here? Now, if I ask you one by one, you answer yes or no. Okay, do you come here for perfume? Mm-hmm. Cosmetics?
No.
What else? Moda, you know, style?
To protect our husband?
That's the answer. V'asalo ezer kenegdo. Your role in your life, that's how you set your mind up. My role is to be ezer for my husband. Ezer kenegdo. What's an ezer called? Ezer, it means to be a support and help for the one who came to accomplish something here. And you're part of him, by the way. Do you know how neshamot? Neshamot are really a one. Adam, neshama, is one neshama. When they come to the world, they split to two parts. One goes to male, another goes to female. Once they get together, they become Adam, they become a person. Okay? So you are the one who are support for the last one that came to do something in this world. Now, in generally, all men, they have to complete Tariyag Mitzvot, 613 Mitzvot, and a woman should be one who helps them to do, to achieve this goal, because both of you get the same Gan Eden. Do you understand that? Both of you. If he learns Torah, you let him to do so, the 50-50 goes. Splits in half, mamash in half. And we know that from Rabbi Akiva. Rabbi Akiva, he was divorced. According to majority opinions, he was divorced. He had already children. He was 40 years old. He was a shepherd of Kalba Savua, and Kalba Savua. Now, he was working for many years for him. And one day his daughter grew up. She was 18 years old, Rachel. She saw that he has a very good midot. He's very trustful first in person, he's very kind person. He was not such a big Talmid Chacham. He was Am Haaretz, Gemara says. He was a regular man. He did mitzvot though, Tosfos says. He completed mitzvot, but he was not learning Torah. She came to him and she told him, if you're going to learn Torah, if you're going to commit yourself to learn Torah, I'm going to be your wife. And he needed it because he was divorced. He needed to get married. So he said, what did I lose? I say, yes. He said, but you know what? I'm already old, 40 years old.
she brought him to the place where the water was dripping on the stone. Then he saw that the water made a hole in the stone. So she says, do you know that there was not a hole here before? Yes, he says, every time water drips, how could water make a hole in the stone? Do you know how, she said? Because it's constant, you know? And by those constant drops of Torah that you constantly learn, that's how it's going to go on you. And he committed himself, they got married, she got rejected by her father. He said, he swore to her that he's not going to give her a penny. He said, the clothing that you said you have on yourself, say thank you that I give you a present, get out of here. And she left the house. She got married to him. And she sent it to learn. They got two babies, boy and girl. She said, go and learn. He left her house for 24 years. For our generation, it's 24 hours. It's already phone calls, text messages, emails, on Twitter and Facebook and anything. And police maybe also. You understand? 24 hours. She sent it for 24 years to learn. He was coming back in an interval of 12 years. 12 years he learned. He came back to see his wife with the kids, how they are doing. Maybe for Bar Mitzvah, his son already. He heard that someone went in the house to the wife and started to put the oil into a fire. He said, you know, your husband probably got married to somebody else. He forgot about you. That back then, they didn't have phone, so they could not interact, you know, with each other. So it was very hard, right? So what happened? He comes back and he talks to her, and she says, if he would hear me now, I will tell him, go back and learn another 12 years. He didn't step to the house. He turned and went back for 12 years. And now what happened after 24 years? He coming back with 24,000 students. It's a big issue. We don't have biggest issue of the world. 24,000 students. The biggest we have is Lakewood and Neil. They have around 7,000 students. But that, he had 24,000 students. And every one of the students, they mechaya mitim, tanaim kedoshim, they were able to resurrect the dead, to put him in, to make him alive. So he comes back. They sit in Big Valley and he gives the lesson and he teaches them Torah. And everybody heard that great Rabbi Akiva comes. They didn't know it's a regular Akiva, a shepherd of Ben Kalba Sevuah. Everybody heard and they come to see who is this great Rabbi Akiva is. So when they came, what happened? Rachel also came after 24 years. If she was 18, and 20 became 20 after he left. So she's now, how old? 44 years old. She comes, she changed. She changed a lot because she suffered. No money support, no nothing. And raising kids alone. And everybody every day nodding on her head, always saying to her, you know what, your husband forgot about you. And what she did, Rachel, she didn't listen to them. She came to see Rabbi Akiva, the Talmidim, they saw, what's a woman doing between a man? They tried to tell her, lady, go to ladies' section. And Rabbi Akiva saw her. He stood up. And because Rabbi Akiva stood up, so everybody sees Rabbi Akiva stands up, every Talmid stands up. You imagine 24,000 students stands up, and Rabbi Akiva looks, and all the Talmidim see the way of his looking and opening up the way. And she said, let her come to me. This is my wife. Sheli veshelachem shelahu. He didn't say 50% of hers. He says, whatever I have, whatever you have, it's all of hers. You know why? Because she let me to be like this. I have you because of her. That's a great mission that she completed. By the way, Ari HaKadosh says that was Gilgul of Yaakov Avinu with Rachel. Her name was Rachel. And Akiva Otiyot Yaakov, right? Akiva, you will see the letters Yaakov inside of it with Aleph. So they came back to teach Torah to Am Yisrael, and the whole Torah that we have today is because of Rabbi Akiva and his wife. And imagine just what wife could do. Now, nobody asks you to let your husband over 24 hours to learn Torah. Just, you should know your mission in this world. You came something to accomplish, to become Ezer Kenigdo, not only just to cook food, and to laundry and to clean the house. That's the basics. But the most important thing, you have to let your husband to accomplish himself spiritually. Once you do so, Eshet Chayil means no. So, once you do such a things, you bring Shekhinah to the house. Okay, it's very important that the Torah learning should be within the house. Not once a week, not once a month, every day. To Alachot, whoever could make a class, 45 minutes between you and your husband, is the best. That's what I advise to all my students, Chatanim. Say, first year, you would sit with your wife, because no babies, no botherings, right? You would sit with your wife, and three Alachot, you have to know where you are. Ilchot Shabbat, inside. Ilchot Tarat Mishpacha, the family purity, and Ilchot Kashrut. Because those three things are daily basic things, and you have to know exactly Alachot what to do by them. Okay? So what do we have to know about Kashrut? There are many things that we don't know about Kashrut. So you have to make sure that you know them very well. And first, yeah, it's very important to make a shiur between you and your husband. And also, it brings to unity, you know, when you talk to your husband, you discuss. You didn't understand something, take a pen, write a question on the side, then you go, later you're going to call to Rav, and you're going to ask those questions that you had. Rav, we had questions like 10, 15 questions, please can you answer? You write the answers, you know, you share with your husband, or your husband shares with you, whatever. No. What is a general obligation of women in mitzvot? Gemara says, and generally, Torah given to everyone, to men and a woman, ladies, right? Everyone has to do Torah, and we promise to do the Torah, to perform the Torah. But certain halachot, a woman were exempt, and there is a reason for that. Look at this, what it says. It says, any mitzvot that they have certain connection with the time, meaning the time causes for those mitzvot to come, a woman are exempt. And Gemara says, women are obligated on all the mitzvot, lo ta'ase, not to do. For example, can a woman kill? Prohibition. No. Can a woman steal? No. Eat not kosher? No. Every prohibition you're obligated, besides three prohibitions. There are three prohibitions only for men. First, it's to shave with a razor, with a blade, sharp razor on a face. That's a prohibition only for men. If somehow women would need, let's say, to shave her sides, not to see the hair, should not be seen when she's married, or whatever, she doesn't want her hair to be seen, she needs to shave it here. She is allowed, according to Halacha, to shave it with a razor. So prohibition only for men. Now, second prohibition is not to shave off the sideburns, right? With the side hair here, we're not allowed to shave. Men not allowed to shave, but the woman has no prohibition to do so. If she would need somewhere for some reason to do so, she's allowed to do it with a razor. Now, the third prohibition, if a woman, she is a daughter of Kohen. Now, we know daughter of Kohen, she's not, the Kohen himself, he's not allowed to contaminate himself with a dead body. Meaning, if in the room, Chas Hashem, there's a dead body, Kohen cannot walk into that room. Or in the building, depends. Or next to the kever, Kohen cannot touch the burial, right, where the body is there. Kohen cannot touch only whatever connected with his relatives and connected with his mourning for his relatives. That's what he could do, but all others not. But what about the daughter of Kohen? It's prohibition in the Torah. It says, lo yitameh ba'al ba'amar le'chalo, and Torah says you're not allowed to contaminate yourself. To who? To Bnei Aharon only. It says, daber el Aharon ve'el banav, speak to Aharon and to his sons. But not the daughters, Talmud says. So daughters of Kohen, they have no prohibition, meaning if they would be in one tent with a dead body, so then, what about if daughter of Kohen pregnant with a boy?
and she's married to Kohen also. So who is her boy?
Kohen.
He's a Kohen. So is he allowed to be in the place of the dead body? He's not. So pregnant woman, until she gave birth, no problem. Once she gave birth, she has to be very careful because he is a Kohen, not to go with this boy to funeral houses, not to go with this boy to even to places, hospitals, where they have dead bodies inside, if it's possible to do other way. You understand? Okay, that's the law. Now, so this is mitzvot lo ta'aseh, this is prohibitions. What about performative mitzvot? How many have we have of them? 248. Now, man, even man, in some of them not obligated because of certain reasons. For example, Kohen cannot do mitzvot pidyon haben. Pidyon haben is only for Israel, mother and father, Israel, and a baby boy that was born, first baby boy, natural way, no miscarriages, no abortions, we do pidyon haben. I think we did your son, pidyon haben, right? So you do mitzvah of pidyon haben, okay? So Kohen himself, if he had a firstborn son, he cannot redeem for to whom he is going to give money to himself. And Levi also patur, because the same family, Levi and Kohen, the same family, they are patur from this mitzvah. Either mother or father from them, they are exempt from this mitzvah. So you see, even in those mitzvot, somebody are exempt, men. Okay. But women are exempt more. Which mitzvot? Connected with the time. Now, shofar, this mitzvah connected to time? Yes, it's once a year, and time causes for shofar to come. Whole year you blow shofar, you don't do mitzvah. On Rosh Hashanah you blow shofar, you do mitzvah, so it's caused by the time. So therefore shofar you exempt. Now again, don't misunderstand. Exempt, it doesn't mean you prohibit it. You allow it. Let's understand those terms. There is a mutar, there is a asur. Mutar, it means permitted. Asur, it means prohibited. You're not allowed to do this. And there is patur. Patur, it means you exempt. You don't have to do it. You wanted to do it, fine. But you don't have to. Now, mitzvah shofar, you exempt. Mitzvah sukkah, you exempt. Lulav and etrog, time caused mitzvah, you exempt from this mitzvah. So now you ask me, what about tefillah, a prayer? Is it connected to time or not? So what do you think?
It is connected.
So you should be exempt. So how can you do it? So it's a minhag? No. You are obligated in Torah by Torah in tefillah. Because tefillah doesn't have time. Talmud says, alvai, it would be better if a person would pray whole day, entire day, but we can't. So Chachamim came and established times for tefillah. The times of tefillah, the times of the prayer, is from sages. But tefillah itself, every moment you want to talk to God, you could talk to Him. So it's not mitzvah caused by time. Tefillah, it's a request from Hashem, Vayirachami Talmud says, to ask for mercy, and to ask for mercy anytime is good. Do you understand that? So therefore, this is a mitzvah that you are obligated. Then later we'll go in depth of those mitzvot.
Musaf?
We didn't discuss it yet, because tefillat musaf is a little different than regular tefillot. We'll go in the depth of every mitzvah, Bezat Hashem, and we'll learn, we'll try to finish this book. And it's good for you that you would know and teach your daughters even that. Okay. Now, there are three mitzvot.
Oh, I have a question.
Yeah.
Like, if we're exempt from the rule of etrog, right? Do we still say, are we allowed to still say the bracha?
No. Once, remember the rule, halacha is, once you are exempt from a mitzvah, you're not allowed to say bracha for that mitzvah, because you're exempt. What do you say? Asher kidishanu b'mitzvotav v'tzivanu. You sanctify us with your mitzvot, and you commanded us. Who commanded you?
Okay.
Nobody commanded you. So you're lying. So how come Ashkenazi, they do so?
you know, minhag, our sisters Ashkenaziot, some Ashkenaziot, they take lulav and etrog and they do say beracha. For that, they have a big argument between Rabbeinu Tam and Rambam. Rabbeinu Tam holds that even on a minhag, even on regular minhag custom, you could say beracha. Do you understand that? We do not follow his opinion because we follow our Rabbi Rambam and Maran Shulchan Aruch. We do not say beracha. You would like to do it, do it. But according to Zohar, don't get mixed up with a man's mitzvot, please. Zohar says women shall not be making lulav and etrog. Zohar says women should not be counting sfirat ha'omer. But they do teach our daughters in yeshivot to do so. So we have to tell them not to do this. Or if they do it with a bracha, at least. Yeah, but anyway, until they understand there's a difference in minhagim. Sfirat HaOmer, you know, you don't know, it's better, you don't know. But anyway, every after second night of Pesach, we start to count. On second night of Pesach, we start to count Omer. Every night for 49 days till Shavuot. So that's what we do.
I have a question for Shofar. For the Shofar, if a woman, you're saying it's exam, she's exam, but if she does listen to it, and
she doesn't say bracha, but she answers for bracha, I mean.
Does she get more blessing? Like, yes, if you compare.
It is a mitzvah. Well, listen, it pushes you to make tshuva. I just spoke about this.
Right.
Elevates your neshama to do tshuva. Why not? Mm-hmm. It's good. It's good that you do. Understand me. Don't misunderstand me. When I say patur, it doesn't mean that's it. I leave this mitzvah and forget about it. You still try to do it. But if you didn't do it, at least HaKadosh Baruch Hu knows that you know at least that you exempt. But you, Yishayirat Hashem, the woman who has a fear of Hashem, she should try to do as much as possible to do the mitzvah. But whatever she is exempt, she is exempt. Okay, she wants to listen to Shofar because Shofar, besides the mitzvah, has a benefit. What's the benefit? You hear Shofar, your neshama wakes up, right? Somebody told me, what if your neshama doesn't wake up? It means your neshama is in coma. You know what coma means? I'll tell you. Coma means a person did so many averot that neshama died. And now to waken up neshama, you need shock. You need to shock him. Once you shock him, and he asks for oxygen, so you give him bra, he asks for food, you understand? That's how you do this.
What about
okay.
Shem Hashem? Shem
Hashem and Tfilot? Yeah, what? Are we allowed to say Shem Hashem? What? In Tfilot? Ador Shem? Yeah. Yeah, you have. Hashem, are we allowed to say? Because we're allowed to say Birkat Halel? Because I heard a woman should have to say. No, Halel, again, Halel is connected to Mitzvah of Chachamim. They're connected to the time. Mm-hmm. Since it's Mitzvah of Chachamim connected to the time, you exempt from Halel. Halel itself, you could say, because it's like 10 capitals of Tehillim. It's a third portion of Tehillim. You're allowed to say Halel.
Okay,
yeah, in Halel, well, then whenever you say Pasuk, you're allowed to say name of Hashem. There is no problem. Bracha you cannot say, because you cannot say Asher Kiddishanu b'mitzvotav v'tzivanu. Who v'tzivanu? Nobody commanded you.
What about the Barachot before Shema?
Also, you cannot say, even though there are Barachot of Shevach, but our sisters Ashkenaziot, they do say, our minhag not to say those Barachot. So therefore, when you pray in the morning and you would like to say a whole set of prayer, in the morning, in a short, what you are obligated is Bichrot HaShachar with Birkot HaTorah, because you will say some Divrei Torah, and you will be obligated only Pasuk of Shema Yisrael and Shmona Yisrael. That's all. That's all your tefillah is. Now, you would like to make it whole thing? Fine, but do not bless. Baruch Sheamar, you do not bless. Yishtabach, you do not bless. Baruch Yotzer Or, you say Baruch Yotzer Or right away. Then also Baruch Gal Israel. You don't say Baruch Ata Hashem Gal Israel. That's you have to be. Our sisters Ashkenaziot, they say the whole thing like a man. We, not like this, because we do not have this mitzvah of Shema Israel. The brachot of Shema Israel were connected to Shema Israel. Since you don't have a mitzvah of Shema Israel, so why do you say brachot? You understand?
So brachot shachar, the beginning brachot, you're allowed to say.
You do. You have to say, because it's praise for Hashem. Everybody has to praise Hashem that Hashem opened your eyes, bokeach hamrim. Everybody has to praise Hashem that Hashem gave you sight and to see or to hear. Everybody, right? So, okay. Now, there are three mitzvot connected. Actually, there are more than three mitzvot connected to the time that still women are obligated.
An example. Matzah, it's mitzvah taseh deoraita. It's mitzvah from Torah to eat a piece of matzah on Pesach, at night of Pesach. Now, how do we perform it? Through eating. Women, are they obligated for that mitzvah? Well, wait a second. How do you say yes if it's connected to the time? The great rule says that anything that caused by the time, women are not obligated. And you don't eat entire matzah. Obligation comes with Pesach. So then you come and you eat matzah. So what do you do with that? So there's a different rule to this. You know, every general rule has ABC behind it, you know, like a sub-rule. To override that rule that says to you, no, in this case, you would be obligated. It says in Torah, 7 days, don't eat chametz, eat matzot, in the same pasuk. So 7 days, Torah prohibited us to eat chametz, and outside of Eretz Israel is 8 days. But Torah says you have to eat matzot. So why Torah said in the same pasuk two things, two opposites, prohibition and mitzvah? Prohibition not eat chametz. Mitzvah to eat matzah. Torah says, whoever is prohibited to eat chametz, he has to eat matzah. Do you understand the learning here? Whoever is prohibited to eat chametz, he has to eat matzah. Again, who is prohibited to eat chametz? Everyone. Are women allowed to eat chametz? Pizza on Pesach. No, for sure no, it's chametz. Whoever is prohibited to eat chametz, he has to eat matzah. So that's how women obligated in matzah. Now, another mitzvah, simchat yom tov. To have a simcha on yom tov. Did you know there's a mitzvah to have a simcha on yom tov? You know what a simcha is? To have a joy on yom tov. You have to enjoy it and have a joy and happiness on yom tov. Did you know about that? I'll teach you, tell to your husbands maybe. Husbands, they have to know, they have to teach them that. But halacha is, Gemara says, v'samachta v'chagecha. You should be happy on a holiday. So Gemara says, everyone he has his own happiness. For men, what's the happiness to learn? Gemara says, basar shemen v'yayin tov. Gemara says, a good steak, right? Fat, good steak. And a good wine. That's a simcha of the ish. For men, that's the best simcha. Now, for the woman, Gemara says, for her, those things are not so much important. For her, what? Gemara says, tachshitim v'bigdei tzivonim. Gemara says, beautiful clothing and beautiful jewelry.
Yeah.
So that's what she enjoys. So, halacha says, since there is a mitzvah of simcha, not only men should be happy with a good steak and wine, a woman also has to be happy. So he gives her a gift card, a present to go to make shopping, whatever. She goes, she buys a nice jewelry for herself, or he buys her a jewelry. And please, it's very important in Shalom Bayit, accept it with love and smile. Because many times husbands, they try their best, and a woman seems to be not liking it, it breaks it. Next time he's not going to be doing it willingly. He's just going to do it because Rabbi said so. You understand? Accept it with joy. Even if it's not so, you know, good for you. You don't like this thing, but still, it's good for Shalom Bayit. Okay, then later you say, you know, we decide, let's upgrade it. You know, we'll sell and buy something new. Yeah, sometimes for husbands it's very hard. What happens, they don't have money and they feel embarrassed. Why do I say this to you? I'll tell you why. Because I'm one of the rabbis of young generation here. They know they have no one to talk to, so they come and talk to me, and they say certain things from where I generate the answer already, what's going on in the house. He said, Rabbi, I don't have money and I'm embarrassed. I have to bring something to my wife. You have taught us that we have to make her happy, and I don't have money, so what I do? So in this case, you would be smart as a chokhmat nashim ban tabeta. You would say, listen, anyway, I'm not wearing it, let's sell it, so you will have money to buy me something different. You know, sometimes renew your jewelry. Don't keep this old jewelry. You could renew it, you could sell it and buy something new. It brings joy also to the happiness in the house. This is just advice, it's not obligation, okay? Just accept it as it was. Now, there is a mitzvah for the child also to get Simchat Yom Tov. So how do you make children happy? Junk food! So you give them junk food. You give them healthy junk food. Okay, you give them candy, lollipops, chocolates. Okay, so chocolate it doesn't give cavities. Yeah, chocolate doesn't give cavities.
So really?
Yeah. The sugar in the chocolate might give a chocolate itself, doesn't give a natural chocolate, doesn't give cavities, so you clean the teeth afterwards. You teach them responsibility. Okay? So what do? You make them, they have to be happy also, kids. And Gemara says, in effect, on a Pesach, you have to make them stay till the end. How do you make them to stay till the end? You know how? He said, I give you present in the end, whoever. they're going to keep you away. Mm-hmm. That's what you do. That's why, because they have to see all settled till the end. In our generation, no problem. They put you to sleep first. They stay till the morning. Okay.
It's some little kids, like.
No, little kids that don't understand. We're talking about the kids that already understand what's a mitzvah, what's a paro.
Age of two?
Huh?
Age of two?
Oh, he already understands from age of two, maybe. It depends on the child. All the mitzvot that depends on the child. Meanwhile, we're not learning about the children how to give them chinuch, but there is a mitzvah of Simchat HaChag. Now, Simchat HaChag is also a mitzvah that comes with the time. So how come women are obligated with this mitzvah? Okay? The women are obligated in this mitzvah, Simchat HaChag. Now, if, let's say, a case, the husband could not make you happy on a chag, so you make yourself happy, because you have to be happy on Simchat HaChag. Okay, it's prohibited to cry on a chag, and Yetzirah will make you cry on a chag. So don't let him do this. He takes those tears and uses it against you. Don't let Yetzirah make yourself happy. Forget about any kas and akpada, any kind of kas, anger that you have. Leave that alone. Start to do Ratzon Hashem. Start to do what Hashem wants from you. It's very hard. Yes.
Do you count Shabbat for Chag for Yom Tov?
Do you? What?
And Shabbat for Yom Tov.
We'll talk about Shabbat now in a sec. Now. And there is another mitzvah, Hakhel. Mitzvat Hakhel, in the time of Bet HaMikdash, there was a mitzvah once in the 50 years. Every person in Israel was supposed to come to Eretz, to Yerushalayim, to Bet HaMikdash, with the kids, with the wives, with everybody, to see Hashem, how Kohen Gadol reads Sefer Torah. It's mitzvah, even it's connected to the time, once in the 50 years. The mitzvah, they have to come. They have to go and do this mitzvah. Now, there's another mitzvah connected to the time every week, and women are obligated in this mitzvah, Shabbat. Shabbat is mitzvah that connected. Sorry. Mitzvah that connected to time. So how come women are obligated to keep Shabbat? Now, don't make a mistake. Shabbat has two mitzvot. Mitzvot aseh and mitzvot lo ta'aseh. Performative mitzvot and prohibitive mitzvot. Now, prohibitive mitzvot of Shabbat, we know there are 39 general malachot, prohibited actions that we're not allowed to do. Now, we said all the prohibitions you're obligated besides three. Shabbat is not connected there, right? Shabbat you do have to keep from prohibitions. Do you have to make kiddush on Shabbat or not?
Yes. Women. Yeah. If husbands are not there,
your husband's not.
If it's not.
Even he is there.
No, you don't make kiddush.
Unless if he's sick.
You have to make kiddush. Meaning, if he makes a kiddush, you don't have to.
Right.
But let's say he didn't make kiddush. Why you make it? It's mitzvah taseh. It's a mitzvah from Torah to do kiddush on Shabbat, connected to the time. So you should be exempt. Our husband has to do it, but you don't have to. Torah says no. It's the same learning like we learned with the Pesach. We have two times in Torah mentioned Ten Commandments. Once in Parashat Yitro, it says, Zachor et Yom HaShabbat LeKadsho. It's a fourth mitzvah. It says, Zachor et Yom HaShabbat LeKadsho. Remember the day of Shabbat in His Holiness.
to sanctify it. Second time, it's in Devarim, Parashat Ve'etchanan, it says, Shamor et Yom HaShabbat Lekadsho. We repeat the Torah, we repeat Ten Commandments, and Ten Aseret HaDibrot, it says, Shamor et Yom HaShabbat Lekadsho. The guard day of Shabbat in its holiness, to sanctify. So what's the difference between Zachor and Shamor? You know, there's a song, Shamor, Zachor v'Shamor, Shamor v'Zachor b'dibur echad, Yishmeyanu ele miyuchat, em lachad dodi v'sein. Why it says Shamor? Is there Zachor and then Shamor? What's the difference? Zachor, Talmud says, it's a mitzvah to remember day of Shabbat by saying Kiddush. Baruch atah Hashem, Mekadesh HaShabbat. Did you say Baruch atah Hashem, Mekadesh HaShabbat? You need mitzvah from Torah. Now, Shamor, to guard from what? From prohibited actions. Torah says twice. Actually, those two words was said in one voice and what at one time by Hashem, which a person could not make. Do you understand? Shamor v'zachor b'dibur echad. It was said in one word by Hashem. Person cannot make it. Shamor v'zachor cannot make it. It has to be one after each other. But Hashem said it at once. Now, you have two mitzvot, Zachor and Shamor. So Talmud says, Kol mi sheyeshno bishmira, yeshno bishira. Whoever is obligated to do Shamor, he is obligated to do Zachor. Who is obligated to do Shamor? Everyone. Everyone is they have to guard Shabbat from Averot. Right? Everyone has to guard Shabbat from not doing something prohibited. Even women. So since the woman are obligated to guard Shabbat from prohibitions, she has to do Zachor also, because the two words are said by one at once by Hashem. Do you understand it? Are there any questions for that? So you are obligated to do Kiddush. So therefore, in the morning, when you wake up, and you are a pregnant woman, you wake up, you want to eat something, even before prayer. In your case, you will have to do Kiddush first, to eat, then to do whatever you need to do if you want to eat. That's halacha, and any sick person also, a lady or a man even. If he's sick, he needs to eat right away, he has to get his medication or whatever. He makes kiddush first, then he eats and drinks, then he goes to pray. But the regular people, healthy people, we do not eat and drink before prayer. So if you feel weak and you cannot stand in the prayer so long, so you could drink a tea, with sweet tea, make a sweet tea, right? With the sugar, whatever you drink it with, the honey, and you could pray, and then you make a kiddush on surah. Yes, any questions about those things that we spoke
when
about?
You mean, like, let's say a lady, she's healthy, she's not pregnant, and she, which prayer do you mean, the morning prayer, or like the whole morning?
Morning prayer.
Just the short?
No, the Shmona Esrei, before Shmona Esrei.
Oh,
it's
preferable
not to
eat. What if there's kids running around, you can't even...
Yeah.
Say the Shmona Esrei.
Right. So what do you do till the later? So you cannot stay hungry. You ask.
Yeah. So you can.
So you make a kiddush first. You have to make a kiddush first.
What if you just want to drink water, like?
Water before prayer, you're allowed to.
Fine, right? Not
yeah.
To douche, not to.
Right.
Okay.
If you do pray regularly, yes.
Okay.
Yes, you're allowed to drink water, tea, even with some sugar.
What about coffee?
Also, you're allowed to. It's good for the health reasons.
Men are also allowed to.
What?
Like men before tefillah, they're allowed to also
drink, yes. To
coffee.
Drink, no problem. Coffee, yes. Also, today we permit it also. No problem. Okay, is there any questions for this topic that we spoke today? And this is a general topic just to show you what we're going to be dealing with here. And then we will go with each topic separately. For example, Shabbat, we'll go over all the laws of Shabbat, and what you're obligated when you are, and especially laws of borer, separating, or laws of cooking, laws of putting back food. That's what needed for you, because you're always in the kitchen, meaning you have to be there in order to serve food, so you have to know those laws. And second, you want to do Shabbat first, so we'll do Shabbat first, because that I asked my Rav, if what should I start first? He said Shabbat. Start with them Shabbat first. Even though many people, and tell me, how many of you learned Shabbat inside, in the books?
Which book would you recommend to them?
Tell the truth, I wrote the book in Russian for Hilchot Shabbat. You could read it. Yes, you could write if you read Russian, but if you don't, the English book, now I'll put Yosef, they translate it into English, but always compare with the Hebrew text, because sometimes, possibly being mistakes sometimes, so you compare first, and you, if you have any questions, you could call and ask. Now, another thing. Yes?
Sorry, about Tefillah that you said before, Kriyat Shema.
Women are not obligated since it's connected to the time. It says Ufshoch Becha Ufkumecha. When you go to sleep, when you go to sleep and when you wake up, it's a mitzvah that connected to time, right? So women are not obligated. It doesn't mean you cannot say it. It's a prohibited for you to say it. You have to say it. You have to say this mitzvah. It's a mitzvah for you to say, right? Okay. But still, it's not a mitzvah as a man.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if you don't have time to say it, you don't have to. But one first pasuk you should say. Why? Because for you there's a different mitzvah, Yichud Hashem. Have you ever heard about this mitzvah? To make unity of Hashem, to make Hashem one. By saying Hashem Echad, you're making Hashem one in the world, and you're pronouncing, you're testifying upon that, and it's a mitzvah. Everybody has blagged, it's no connection to the time. It's always mitzvah. So therefore, the first pasuk, Shema Yisrael, you would be able to keep. But if you could say, Hol Shema Yisrael, Chazak Baruch. Yes.
I also heard that you have to say a prayer for a certain time, a month a lot.
Right.
So women also obligated to do it?
If you do Shacharit, yes. If you do Shacharit, yes. Mincha, if you decided to daven Mincha, that's a proper time for you, but till the time of Mincha. You cannot just go around and find any tefillah, like, you know, like in the machines. Stop it. Shacharit. Go pray Shacharit. You don't do this now.
So we just have a mitzvah to pray once a day, no matter what, whenever we find.
Preferably all the tefillot, if it's possible.
Okay.
But if it's impossible, at least once a day you have to pray.
It doesn't matter which one.
Well, preferably you set up yourself a day, time.
Mm-hmm.
It's better to set up the time. Okay? Yeah.
I'm sorry. About Kriyat Shema.
Kriyat Shema. Okay.
When I didn't say Kriyat Shema, I felt different.
Right, it is. It is. You have, you see, you have to differentiate. You have to say, or you should say, or not. Should you say it? Yes, you should say it. Do you have to say it? No. Sometimes it happens in such situations that you feel bad that you missed this. Yes, you should have such a feeling. It means your neshama is alive because you feel that you lost mitzvah. But you have to know halacha also. Should
you? I don't know. Someone said that you have to create your mom. My mom took it upon herself. I took it upon myself.
So you took upon yourself. It's good. But it's not, it's still you're getting reward for that, again. But it's not obligation as a man. In a hundred, after 120, men will come, they will say to him, why didn't you reach my Israel? For you, then I'm not going to say.
What if there's an option of Shabbat that you only have a light in the bathroom open, and you want to say Kriyat Shema? Are you allowed to use that light in the bathroom to say Kriyat Shema? Everything else is off. There's no other lights in the front.
Halacha is you're not allowed to pronounce name of Hashem next to the open, an open door of the bathroom.
Mm-hmm.
But what you could do, if you open the door of the bathroom and you go far away, four steps, no smell, no nothing, and you will stand with the back to the bathroom, not to the front of the bathroom, on the sides of the bathroom,
mm-hmm.
with the back, meaning the light going to be like this, from the back of the back.
Mm-hmm.
Then you laugh. But this is only in such a situation. So for next Shabbat, you would know to leave one light, at least one light. Okay. For Shabbat Kodesh, HaKadosh Baruch Hu gives you open check, so for electricity, you don't have to worry about that. Yeah, that's what it says in Gemara. HaKadosh Baruch Hu gives you open check. Yeah, any other questions? No questions. Next time, please, tell to your friends, we're starting a new series of lectures. It's going to be Alaha. What women have to do, and what they are obligated, what they're not obligated, and with that shame. Thank you very much. Okay, this is the card. Whoever would like to contact me, whatever questions you have, my information there.